We're on the clock now with 2 weeks worth of headlines to get after. Let's get going. Down south, where the Las Cruces Tea Party's 4th of July float flew a number of flags, including the Confederate one. Now, the float won an award. The award was rescinded. After the whole thing blew up, the mayor of Las Cruces actually apologized. But the Tea Party says it's part of New Mexico's history. Now, keep in mind, Mexican and Spanish flags were not on the float, Jamie. And can the Tea Party stick with this? Or should they apologize, or what should happen here?
Well, the first thing is I've talked to several of the Tea Party members down there, because I'm being from Las Cruces, I know some of them. And I can tell you this, I've been to their meetings, they're not racist. There's no ill intent by putting the Confederate flag on the float. But floats are an expression of art. I mean, would we agree that you're trying to express something in a creative way by putting the flag there out of context and not putting it with, you know, side by side with the Spanish flag or the Mexican flag, and you know, there were reasons they say why those flags were not put on the float, that there could have been a little bit more thought towards this.
Sure. This is much ado about nothing. It's much ado about nothing. I mean, this same flag flies over six flags of Texas. The same flag flies over all the six flags places. The flag itself,
we don't have six flags here.
It doesn't matter.
About?
It's flying today. The flag itself, the flag itself has nothing to do with this stuff. It's the people who use the flag for bad things. When the Ku Klux Klan walks in a rally with this flag, that's bad. When some guy flies it at a football game at the University of Georgia, that doesn't make him a racist.
Just a few seconds left. 10 seconds for you, sir, if you would.
I'm just pretty insensitive, and just, again, proves that the Tea Party folks are getting to be like bozos as they mature more and more, you know, so
you're a roll tonight.
I am absolutely down on the Tea Party on this. I do think they need to apologize. I think they need to recognize, and they should have done it right away, recognize that they made a big mistake. I'm also going to say of Las Cruces, listen, best float next year, 4-H, Girl Scout, somebody like that. Why would you give best float to a political group?
That was the tough one right there. Now, the Albuquerque Convention Center is slated to receive an extreme makeover, this $20 million facelift. With funds from the city's refinance convention center, bonds is expected to significantly boost bookings, Richard. Everyone says the bookings will increase. But I will say, on the artist rendering, guys, compared to what we have now for the convention center, that might as well have been the Louvre, right? That might as well have been the entrance to the Louvre. It looks spectacular. But is this the trick we need to get? Is it just a facelift that's going to get more bookings?
You know, I'm glad that they're talking about fixing it up. You know, I'm still concerned about the debt service. I think it was like around $70 million when I was running a few years ago, and I'm still concerned about that. But I think it would be good, and anything we can do to get more tourists here, I think it'd be great.
Is it due time, Dan?
You know, it clearly, if you've been in there, it needs to be fixed. It's attracting some nice things. These track meets that they're attracting, the Nationals and stuff like that, big deals. I think it'll help more people want to come. I think if you have a choice between that building and you go look at something in San Diego, you're going to choose that. I personally would like to see us retire some more of that debt before we start spending more of that money. We got some big problems
with
finances.
The mayor says he can pay for it.
Right, he can, because he's got his savings.
Right, exactly. What do you think?
But the market for conventions is low, and it's been low for the entire decade.
And you're competing with San Diego and San Antonio.
If we really wanted to compete, we should have chosen to compete on this 20 years ago. And so now I kind of think that you're throwing money at this thing, and it could probably be used to different things. It may be too late for Albuquerque.
Going to hold you there. So if New Mexico schools received their first official A through F grades, they weren't great, but they do show some improvement over the former AYP, or Adequate Yearly Progress Rating. Still, there were more C's than any other grade and a fair share of F's, Rich. I'm going to start with you again. I guess the fundamental question here is, are we learning anything with this letter grade system? Do we know more about our schools using this system?
Well, I think it's better than what we had with No Child Left Behind. There's no question about that, because that was confusing. But this is still confusing. I mean, people still don't understand why they were an A now and a C today.
Or the way around.
It's just still confusing, and I think it really points back to the Department of Education. They really need to do a better job of explaining how you get to an A.
Right.
I mean, a teacher's required to do that when they're giving out grades, when they talk to their students.
Sure.
They should do the same.
Yeah, you agree with that?
I'm actually not that surprised, by the way, to hear that the large number of C's. C is average. I think we sort of forget that.
Good point.
You gotta have somebody average, right?
Right, we can't be like Wobegon, where every school is above average. It just doesn't work that way. Right, it just doesn't work that way. So, I mean, I think that to the extent that we are able to track this over time, we have consistency over time, this could become a useful tool. This year, it's not the tool that we need.
Interesting. Next subject, and I'll hold you there, Jamie. New Mexico Senator Tom Udall says it's time to put the sport of horse racing back on the right track. I love that little pun there. At a Senate committee hearing, This week, meeting on Thursday, yesterday, on medication and performance-enhancing drugs in racing, Udall said federal regulations need to be put in place to end abuse of the sport and save horses, jockeys, and jobs. Daniel, you're laughing, but has this gotten to the point where the feds just have to step in
here? No, I'm laughing because I love it when a U.S. senator or the president, regardless of party, there's a problem and the feds will fix it.
Exactly.
I mean, I'm not sure that the answer is the feds fixing it.
Well, the industry doesn't seem to want to fix it. So
well,
who needs to fix it?
But I mean, you got to figure something out here. Uh-huh. There's clearly a problem.
Okay.
Clearly a problem. Mm-hmm. But I mean, we talked about this on the show ad nauseum. The minute they pass one thing, they're going to have a second drug. They're going to figure out a way around it. It's clearly a problem in the industry. Somebody's got to do something. I think it's good that the state's starting to make a stance.
This seems to me a beautiful opportunity for Mr. Udall on Western Legacy horses, right? I mean, this just works. It works for him.
You know, the question that I always ask when you start fixing things like this is, what are the consequences going to be when you bust somebody?
Right.
It's kind of like the liquor industry and liquor licenses, you know? You abuse your liquor license. You sell to kids underage.
Right.
But what happens? One chance after another. After another. And
same with DWI.
Yeah, I mean.
Good point. Let me get Jamie in here with down a short time, please.
I agree with these folks. I mean, the idea that, I applaud Senator Udall for doing something on anything. Mm-hmm. But in this case, you know, there needs to be at least an opening of conversation. I'm not sure that federal regulation is going to do anything, though.
Can you do it in 5 seconds, Sophie? What do you think?
I think there needs to be consistency across the country's racetracks. That's what I'm interested in, whether it's the industry itself does it, the government has to step in.
There you go.
Just make it
there
consistent.
24 horses a month die in this country. It's ridiculous. So anyway, that's all the time we have for this week. Thanks you all for being here. Thanks for spending an hour with us this week. Now, it may be July, but there are less than 4 months to go before the November election, and we're preparing a full slate of candidate interviews and debates. Follow all the action online on our Facebook and Twitter accounts. I'm Gene Grant. We'll see you next week in Focus.